we have a complicated set of differential equations to solve, but we have to make them even more complicated to account for the effect of turbulence. Turbulence is a vast topic, and I'll just give you a brief overview. You could, for instance, turn to Module 5 in my online course at edx.org, where I solved the turbulent flow over an airfoil, a canonical problem, and that's a place you could get more information, and then you could dig even further. There's lots of information on turbulence, for instance, on the internet. So turbulent flow is fluctuating, but not about the laminar solution. If I go into the flow that we have and track, say, you know, the axial velocity versus time, I will see something like this. So I've plotted axial velocity versus time as, you know, this is a schematic view of it. And you'll see these random fluctuations. And these fluctuations happen over very short time scales. So even with the powerful computers we have now, you cannot resolve these fluctuations for most practical problems. However, you can take a look at the average. So you can take an average over a sufficiently long time period compared to the fluctuations. And that average, which is called the Reynolds-Averaged, and it's denoted by this over bar, is something that we can calculate. So we take our variables and we decompose them according to the Reynolds decomposition, which is you decompose them into the average and a fluctuation. Here I've shown it for the axial velocity. You could do this for, you know, other components of velocity, for pressure and so on. And this is what we are after. So we want to calculate the average, the Reynolds average quantities, that we can calculate. Now, if I take an example, this is from the Ansys training documentation of turbulent flow over a backward facing step. Now, if I take the instantaneous value that contains the average as well as the fluctuation, I'll see something like that. And if I take a lot of these snapshots and I average them, I'll get the time average view. And you can see this is, you know, this mirrors out a lot of the details, but it's still useful to engineers. So we'll get a time averaged solution, and, you know, we won't be able to get a solution that resolves all the fluctuations. And to get the governing equations for the average, what you do is you take the Reynolds decomposition for each variable and you plug it back into the governing equations. And you get the Reynolds average governing equations that look the same as what we had before, except that now, you know, you have to put an over bar over all the variables to remind ourselves that this is the Reynolds average entity. And you know, conservation of mass looks the same. Conservation of momentum looks almost the same, except that you have these extra turbulent terms. And similarly for conservation of energy, you get these extra turbulent terms. And these turbulent terms depend on unknown fluctuating quantities like Vz prime and so on. And so you need to know, you know, you need to have information about the fluctuations to calculate that. And what's done in turbulence modeling is you can calculate approximately these terms by relating them to the mean quantities using some kind of semi-empirical relations. And a lot of this is inspired guesswork, and they're useful, they have problems, and we'll use one particular type of turbulence model, the k-epsilon turbulence model, which is used a lot in engineering despite, you know, having problems. It can give us useful results, and it does in this case. K is the turbulent kinetic energy, so it's a measure of how much energy is contained in the fluctuations. More the fluctuations, turbulent fluctuations, more is the turbulent kinetic energy. Epsilon is the turbulent dissipation. It's a measure of the rate at which the turbulent kinetic energy is dissipated. So if I have a box of fluid and I shake it vigorously and I set up turbulence in it, the faster I shake it and the more vigorously I shake it, the greater are going to be the fluctuations, the greater is going to be the turbulent kinetic energy. Now, when I stop shaking it, you know, the fluctuations are going to die down, and more the turbulent dissipation, the faster it'll die down. And we need to solve two additional conservation equations, one each for K and epsilon. Each of these is a differential equation that looks, you know, similar to, say, the momentum equation. And then the unknown turbulent terms in our governing equations are calculated from k and epsilon. So for instance, you know, if you have the momentum equation, and here I don't have the over bars, I should put the over bars. So think of it as, you know, the momentum equation with the over bars, and then the turbulent terms you calculate from k and epsilon. So the final set of Reynolds-Averaged governing equations with the k-epsilon turbulence model looks like, you know, what we had before plus the k and epsilon conservation equation. So you have two additional differential equations which you'll use to calculate these terms. And that's a closed set of equations. And now we have seven unknown functions, okay? So we have the five we had before, the Reynolds average versions of it, and then you have k and epsilon. And we have six differential equations plus this one algebraic equation. So that's the system we have to solve. And aren't we glad we have a tool like Fluent that will solve it for us.